Welcome to IGN Anime Club, episode 46, Yanime!
Yanime!
I'm back!
Yay!
Finally! I missed everybody! Anytime you miss more than one episode, it feels like an eternity.
It really does.
So I'm your host, Marina Sanchez. And joining me, this is a very full room, and I'm super excited, Mike Mamone, our newest host.
Always glad to be back.
Kelly Plagey.
Hello.
And Megan Sullivan.
Hello.
And we have a very special guest with us, and I'm super excited because she's actually a magical girl in real life, Nina Freeman.
Hello. Yay, anime.
Yay!
I just said yay, and then I was like, wait, I have to say anime.
So Nina, you've worked at a lot, especially Sybil, which is really fun and cute and pretty. And
thank you.
Sybil's so pretty.
Yeah, it's just like, oh,
and
this
I got a lot of feelings.
Yeah,
all the feels, things.
Yay,
so you're in a good way.
Can I tell everyone a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, totally. So I'm Nina Freeman, and I'm a level designer at Fulbright right now, working on Tacoma. I didn't work on Gone Home. Everyone always thinks I did. I started working with them after Gone Home. They're amazing. I recently shipped a game called Sybil that we were just mentioning with my team, Starmade Games.
That's spelled C-I-B-E-L-E. A lot of people have asked me before. I think I mentioned it once.
C-I-B-E-L-E. Yeah, everyone always asks me, and I'm just like, I'm sorry, I picked like a game name. And no one ever, like, everyone's always like, how do I pronounce this? And I don't even know if I'm pronouncing it correctly, but I totally stole the name from a girl I really liked in high school, and she said it that way, so I've always stuck with it. So shout-outs to that girl.
You're famous now.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm a writer and a game designer, and that's my stuff.
Yeah, and you have amazing anime tattoos.
Yeah, I know. I have a Sailor Moon tattoo.
She's a Sailor Moon tattoo.
I just saw that.
Yes,
if you're not watching the video, you should definitely go to the video right now.
I mean, you should always watch videos. We do weird things.
Yeah.
You
can watch it on your TV now.
Yeah. So we got to bring up, you can watch IGN and view IGN in many places.
Yeah.
Like your consoles.
PS4 app.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Xbox One app.
We got some
other things.
If you haven't checked out in a while, we also updated our mobile apps too. Yeah. So those run a little bit better and they're cooler.
Yeah. It works like Tinder now, or it's like going to. It's so cool.
Yeah. So you can personalize it a little bit more too.
You can customize it so you can be like, I only like anime. I hope you don't only like anime, but maybe you do. Yeah. That's okay. But yeah, the new app is cool.
Yeah. And another cool thing we've been working on IGN, because we have to give this a shout out, because we want our stuff to win. Okay. So we're doing a feature called Super Team 64, and we've done this a few years now.
Yeah.
And we have a bunch of teams battle up against each other.
It's sort of like March Madness, but
with
really nerdy.
With nerdy teams. Yeah. So like, we have the Powerpuff Girls and the Sailor Senshi and all these other great anime things that you should vote for. So go check it out and vote for Sailor Moon.
Yeah.
So anytime. Guys, we finally get to talk about Sailor Moon.
I know.
Okay, so if you guys weren't with us like the beginning of when we launched Anime Club, we always had this running joke about Sailor Moon because we would always bring up Sailor Moon. Like every episode for like 10 episodes. And we're like, guys, will you guys just stop talking about Sailor Moon? Like, no. It's in our hearts and it's part of who we are.
It's the greatest anime ever.
And then eventually we had to move on. But no, I used to bring it back.
Yeah.
Before we jump into topics, let's talk about what we've been watching. But first off, Nina.
Yes.
I always corner the guests. I'm like, hey, what's your favorite anime?
Hey. So my favorite anime changes like every day, as I'm sure everyone's favorite anime does. I thought hard about this. I guess I have three. So first, obviously Sailor Moon is like probably my most favorite anime of all time. I mean, I have a huge Sailor Moon tattoo on my arm, so like, if it wasn't on this list, that would be pretty weird.
Yeah, regret.
Yeah. I mean, it's one of those shows that I watched as a kid, and then like as an adult, also watched again and read the whole manga, and was like, I still love this, which is like kind of rare. I don't know. Like, my taste really has changed a lot, but that one has like maintained my interest over the years. And I guess my other two, one would be Robot Carnival, which is like kind of an older series. It's a set of short films that was made, I think, in the 80s. Have any of you guys seen Robot Carnival?
No.
Oh my gosh, yeah, I love recommending this to people. It's seriously amazing. Some of the animators went on to do like Gundam and Akira and like some really famous stuff later in their careers. So it's some of the like most amazing animation that you'll see. It's so, so good. And it's basically, they're all about robots. So it's just like short anime films about robots, sort of like from the various perspectives of the of these different anime creators. And I have a tattoo of that too.
Which is oh, cool.
Yeah. This That's one so cool. is called Cloud, and it's gorgeous. They're all gorgeous. And some are kind of experimental, and I like don't see what I would consider experimental anime very often, but this kind of fits the bill, I think. So really cool. And then finally, Perfect Blue is probably my favorite movie of all time, in addition to one of my favorite anime, which I assume probably most of you have seen Perfect Blue.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So incredible. Like, one of the best like explorations of a female pop star that I've ever seen in a film or in media. So I think those are probably my three favorites.
Solid.
Nice.
Yeah. I know, I was like preparing, I was like, what do I say about all these like incredible anime? Like, I don't even know how I can do them.
You're lucky because I prepared you ahead of time. Sometimes I just forget to tell people that I asked them that question and they're like, oh. I mean, that's how I am whenever anybody asks me that, except with anime. That's like the one exception where I'm like, I have a solid favorite.
Oh, I don't have a favorite anything. I'm like, okay.
Yeah, everything else. I'm just like, I like
these wildly different things, and I can't tell you why.
Yeah. Well, cool. Have you been watching anything recently, Nina?
Yes. I actually just finished two shows that I have been watching. So I finished Peach Girl, which I've been kind of on like a romantic comedy binge lately. So I watched Peach Girl. Oh, is Peach Girl a romantic comedy? I guess it's kind of part that and part like soap opera drama. Mm-hmm. But that's really good. I don't know, romantic comedy anime is just like so funny. Like the writing in those shows, I just find so hilarious and like, it just makes me happy to watch romantic comedies. Ever since I watched Kami-sama Kiss last year, I've just been like obsessed.
That's what I've been meaning to watch too. And I heard the manga is really good.
It's so good. Yeah, I haven't read the manga, but the anime is super good. So yeah, Peach Girl, which is really good. I recommend it, especially if you like really super dramatic anime that is also kind of funny. And also, what else did I watch? Oh, Lovely Complex. So I'd heard that that's like one of the greatest anime romantic comedies of all time, and it totally like fits that bill. It just blew me away. I guess the it's like gimmick sort of, it's not really a gimmick, is that it is about a really tall girl and a really short guy. And it's about how basically they fall in love. And it's super adorable.
Height differences. Yeah.
And it addresses that and like so much other stuff about romance in like such a mature way while also being like totally funny and cute. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's just super good. And the tall girl, short boy thing is adorable. And they're kind of like a comedy duo throughout the whole show. And it's just like the cutest thing. So those are the two that I just finished.
Awesome.
Cool. Yeah. Cool. Kelly, you said you watched a Britney Spears video.
Yeah, so my weekend was a lot of hanging out and watching music videos. So I watched this Britney Spears video I had never seen before. It's the video for Break the Ice. And it's just animated for some reason.
That's amazing.
But it's so bad. And it's super like Ghost in the Shell sort of aesthetic, but horrible. And it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun to watch.
How many times did you watch it?
Just once. But then I watched a different music video. And this fits, you know, Nina being here, because it was sort of like she's like this pop star. Have you heard Call Your Girlfriend by Robin?
No.
So the video is so cool because it's a single cut of her dancing and singing the song. But she's so magical. And I watched that like legit a dozen times.
It must be amazing.
Yeah, it was an interesting, not super great weekend. So I didn't get to watch a lot of anime, but that's okay. I did watch a horrible, horrible anime-inspired video. So.
That counts.
It sort of does.
There's anime everywhere, guys. Don't forget.
Anime is real.
Anime is real.
I love that Pharrell anime music video. Did you see that?
Yeah.
You just made me think of that. I'm like, that really is an anime music video.
Yeah, like they hired I forget exactly who, but he does a lot of cool art and stuff. Mm-hmm. And so he knew what he was doing.
Oh, yeah. It's beautiful. It's like really pretty.
I forget which song that is, too. We talked about it like on a podcast before, forever ago. But yeah.
I also, so you know the song Kids by MGMT? like song. It's an oldish song. Like reminds me of like high school.
Yeah, me too. I was thinking I used to listen to that in high school.
That was so cute. That was so cute.
Moment of silence.
Look at me for Miranda.
Rip glasses. So if you're not watching the video, I just sneezed my glasses off.
If you're not watching the videos at this point, you're missing out on a lot of stuff like that.
Yeah, you really are.
But
they're too big for my face.
I also watched a different music video. I was at a friend's house, and so we just were watching. I'm sorry, we're watching a lot of music videos. But I watched the music video for Kids for the first time, and it was like a Junji Ito thing. Like, it was disturbing. Like, it was this, like, small toddler being haunted by, like, clickers from The Last of Us.
No! No!
And I was like, did they really make that child, like, film with actors and makeup? Because that's awful.
That child is traumatized for life.
And then it turned animated, and it was just, like, body horror. And I was like, what is going on? And then I was like, listen, everybody, we got to watch Yamishibai now. Because if you haven't watched Yamishibai, Japanese Ghost Stories, it's little vignettes of Japanese horror. So, like, Japanese folklore. And it's not super scary. It's more just, like,
creepy.
Yeah, it's creepy. It's just, yeah. So, just kidding. I did watch anime. Can never be without anime.
Yeah, I've been watching a lot of anime movies recently because I've been reviewing a bunch. Recently, I reviewed Psycho Pass the movie. Hey. It was pretty good. It's good. Yeah.
Yeah.
It worked.
Go read the review on IGN.com if you want to know how Miranda feels.
Oh, what a great site.
Wow. That's amazing. I don't know if you've heard of it.
Oh my god.
But
I think
you can
see my shirt.
It's on the wall too.
This is so creepy.
Yeah, so I reviewed that. I also reviewed The Boy and the Beast recently. So if you want my thoughts on those, I don't want to talk about it. I'm tired. But I do want to talk about some other things I've been watching. Because I actually had to marathon all of Psycho Pass in order to do the movie because it takes place after the second season, and I'd already watched the first season. But the second season, I was like, man, at least only 11 episodes. So I got that done. And to take a break from everything, because it's been a lot of the shows I'm watching have been kind of tense, I watched this new show called She and Her Cat, and it's the cutest thing. So it's a short, it's about 7 minutes long, and it's told from the perspective of this cat and how he views his owner. And the animation is just really cute, and it's pleasant, and I have cats, and I love cats. And so after I watched this, it was like a really touching story about how this girl's trying really hard to get a job. Like, she's just out of school, like she's still kind of in school. I think she's finishing up, and she's looking, and she just comes home. She's so stressed, and this cat's like, I don't really know what's going on, but I just want to be there for her. And she has the most beautiful fur, and she's the cutest girl, and I want to make her happy. And all these like really cute things. It's just like,
relationship goals.
Yeah, and so then I just, afterwards, I turned to my cat, and I was just like, why don't you do that for me? Anime setting unreal expectations for life.
But that's too real.
But then, yeah, after I yelled at my cat. I have two cats. I have our baby cat and then my cat that I've had since college. And my cat since I have college, like she used to like lay on my chest, and she's really sweet, and she'd cuddle.
And one's named after a league champion.
Yeah, her name's Ari.
And the other one is a Dota hero.
Yeah. We have Ari.
I just best. Really wanted to point that out.
Yeah, we have Ari and Mortred the Phantom Assassin. So they're always, Dota is always with you. anyway, after I yelled at the older cat, Ari, because she used to be like really sweet, and then she kind of just got... She's a teen now, so she doesn't like me anymore. I yelled at her, and then afterwards, like not too long, she just came and like laid with me on the bed. I was like, oh, it worked! I shamed her into loving me.
Teens crave discipline.
Yeah, so it's a really sweet short. The second episode's out too. I think you should check it out.
I love those short form shows. I feel like I've been coming across a lot of them, and it's like nice to have little nuggets, little morsels of anime.
Yeah.
They're really good.
Shout out to Wakagozake.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I'm obsessed with that show.
We also had a lot more like just higher quality good ones. I mean, maybe because they weren't picked up before as much, but I feel like there's just been so much more the past year and a half or so of just shorts that are awesome.
Yeah.
One that I would recommend that's a short form anime that is one of my favorite animes is Ebichu. Has anyone seen that?
Mm-hmm. I've heard of it, but I haven't actually seen it.
It's kind of perverted, so warning about that. But I highly recommend it if you want to watch an anime hamster run around doing really cute and crazy stuff.
That sounds awesome.
It's also a little disturbing, so just warning.
Okay. Yeah, you said anime hamster is like Himtaro. It's like, give me the Himtaro feel as I'm down. Yeah.
It is like the very adult version of Himtaro.
Yeah, I'm up. Yeah. I'm up right now. Yeah.
So about that life.
Yeah, and so aside from that, I also went in theaters and saw Only Yesterday because, guys, we had like three anime movies in theaters for a weekend. Wow. It was amazing.
That's so much.
Yeah, there was Kizumonogatari, Only Yesterday, and Boy and the Beast. And then Psycho Pass starts today and tomorrow, which is Tuesday, Wednesday. And so it's just like, so much anime. It's great. But yeah, I also have more that I watch, but I don't want to keep talking, so... Mike, what are you doing?
Well, you watched, and I watched, Digimon Adventure Tri,
the second...
Five to eight? Or
yeah, it's like the second set. So the movies are being released as episodes, but four at a time. It's just this really weird thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, I watched the first two of the four.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
I only had time for that.
Yeah, well, I mean, the first four, you know, it was kind of a slow burn.
Yeah.
And then by this second set, it's getting there. Yeah, and can I just say, I don't like Joe. Does anyone like Joe?
Joe's annoying.
He's the one with Gomamon.
Yeah,
he's always like complaining.
I like him in this one because they do capitalize on his cowardice and how he is the oldest and he's dealing with all these like major life changes. So at this point, they're older in Digimon, and Joe is the oldest and he's trying to get ready for college and for like entrance exams. And this is such an important thing to him. Trying to like become an adult, but at the same time, like his childhood is like kind of coming back to haunt him in a way. And he's like, I don't have time for this. I don't have time to be a Digidestined. I need to go to school. I need to study because I'm like, failing.
That sounds a lot like what actually happened to me when I was applying to colleges, and I was like, I can't play Pokemon White. I can't do it. I need to go to college.
Yeah. So I think even though like he's easy to hate on, but I think what they do with him is really smart. Like I think. Him and Mimi are the best characters so far. I mean, they're the only ones who've really gotten time to develop. Like, the first four episodes were okay.
Mm-hmm.
And that these ones that I've seen so far are much better.
No, he redeems himself. It just makes me sad when, like, Gomamon's sad, you know?
It's come on, no. It's like, dude, you're making your Digimon oppressed. Get together.
But, it's super good. It's going to be a while before they release the next.
Yeah, the next one's not out until it's, like, September.
All right. But anyway, yeah, it was good.
Yeah, Digimon's good.
Oh, and also Erased. Anyone watching Erased?
I didn't get to watch it yet.
Okay, that's the thing about talking about ongoing shows that I don't want to talk about spoilers. But,
I was going to watch it and then stuff happened.
Yeah, I don't. Yep. But it was.
That cliffhanger.
That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
I think there's only like two episodes left.
Yeah,
there is.
Oh my God. No.
Nina, have you seen Erased?
I haven't. I feel like I need to catch up on new stuff. I've just been so lost in old stuff lately.
Yeah.
So,
what I try to do is watch some new with like at least one older show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because my backlog is library.
Yeah. Cool.
I feel like I'll start again once the next season of Food Wars comes around.
Yeah.
And then I'll just start freaking out and watch everything that's new because I'll be like, I need to like satiate myself between episodes of Food Wars.
So
good.
Yeah. My mom's gonna be like that. She's gonna like watch them as soon as they come out and then like not know what to do with herself.
Yeah.
Erased, I mention it every time we bring it up because if this is the first time you're hearing us talk about Erased, it's very important to know that it's really heavy, and you should go in knowing that there's stuff about child abuse. So if that's something that's you can't deal with or you don't want to deal with, then I would avoid it. But it's a really well done show, and they handle it very well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's such a great. It almost feels like it's directed like a movie in a way.
Yeah,
it's
really beautifully done.
Yeah, it's very captivating. It's smart.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
It knows its audience, and it kind of is applicable to all audiences. So like it's mystery and there's a point where maybe you may have figured it out. Like you could probably figure out early on if you really look at stuff. But also if you didn't, then it's like a good surprise too. So yeah. Anyway. Anime is real good.
Yeah. That sounds so good.
Yeah. It's just really smart and it makes me happy when we have really smart shows like that. Yeah.
It's probably the most popular one right now, right? I would say.
Yeah, it's the one I'm seeing people talk about the most, besides like Konosuba, which people have been mad at me for not liking it right away. I only watched like two episodes. I'm gonna pick it up again.
Yeah, that's one.
Because a lot of people are recommending Konosuba to me.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's the one where the
I'm just really
guy
tired
goes into
of,
the RPG
I'm
world.
I'm tired of that.
I feel, yeah. I really feel bad. I did not like the first two episodes, and everyone's like, why didn't you like it? And
I wasn't
like,
really a fan of the first episode either.
Yeah, and I was no like, just because I all funny. It was, it wasn't even good anime booty. It was just,
yeah,
it was just. It was too much. I was like, I'd rather be watching like Kill la Kill. I don't know. So,
cool. Yeah. So I binge watch all 26 episodes of Beck Mongolian Chop Squad.
Amazing, oh.
Which is an amazing, really amazing anime. It's the kind of anime you can recommend to friends who don't like anime. It's very westernized because it's so grounded in reality. It's about this kid named Koyuki who wants to learn the guitar. He wants to join a rock band, but rather than being a smooth story arc full of laughter and fun and friends, and they become popular and world famous and everyone loves them. It's the gritty reality of what it's really like to start a rock band, play in dingy clubs, deal with shady characters, and then on top of that, Koyuki has to still deal with being a middle school and a high school kid. He's badly bullied all the way up until the end. He has to still deal with schoolwork and awkwardness with girls. There's no straight happy ending. There's no easy answers presented. It's really a coming of age story. And if you liked Boyhood or you liked My So-Called Life, this is like the perfect anime to recommend to you. It's just, it's really well done. It's like Boyhood meets Green Day. Like, it has really awesome rock music. So highly, highly recommend it. It's a little older. I think it came out in like 2007 or something like that. Mm-hmm. But it's really well done. I watched it in the dub, even though the sub is supposed to be funny because Maho always speaks in broken English, and it's supposed to be really funny. She would swear and curse in like broken English, but I watched a dub, which is really good. And yeah, if you want something a little more grounded and you love music, this is definitely the show to watch.
That's cool. I'll check that out.
Yeah,
that's
very
a
good.
Really good show.
Yeah. Really, really good.
I also recommend watching it like with Nana, or like watching them both, because Nana is kind of like the view of that sort of thing, but more in the like feeling side of stuff and like with like friendships and relationships, whereas Beck is like really like the depiction of like the day-to-day life, like businessy stuff. It's two interesting sides of like the music.
Yeah.
Music stuff.
Yeah, I like that Nana's like the female-centric version, and then like Beck is sort of the male-centric version.
And like a younger, because he's like 14, right?
Yeah, he's 14 when the show begins.
Yeah, and Nana, really, they're a little older, I think.
Yeah, they're a little bit, because they go off to college, art school, and then they
Yeah, I feel like they look at similar topics in interesting ways that kind of play off of each other nicely if you watch both of them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very cool.
Awesome.
Cool. We've been watching a lot.
Yes. But it's all good.
It's all good, yeah. And now back to our topic. I'm so excited. I've been excited for this forever. We've actually been kind of saving this because I was hoping we were going to have you on the show. And it's like, if we're going to talk about Magical Girls, we're going to have to talk about it when Nina's here.
Oh my gosh. I am obsessed with Magical Girls, so that's perfect for me.
And I hope the guys in the audience are like gung-ho about it as well, because I feel like some guys are intimidated by the whole Magical Girl thing, but it's like bronies. Like, there's no shame in loving Sailor Moon.
Yeah.
Especially when you get all those leggy girls running around.
No, I had like a ton of friends growing up who also liked Sailor Moon. Like, it wasn't always a Dragon Ball versus Sailor Moon. It's like, oh, I can like both. Surprise. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think a lot of people definitely watched both, because I think they were aired like right row.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I remember being like, Sailor Moon's over. Okay, time for Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, totally.
Yeah, they hit big at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
So,
Mike, what are your thoughts?
Oh, yeah. No, I grew up with Sailor Moon alongside like Voltron, other shows like on UPN.
Yeah.
Back
Me
in the day.
Too, UPN.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm Saturday so glad to give a shout out to that.
Yeah. So, yeah, no, I'm totally down. Yeah.
Cool. All right. So, to kick this off, I want to ask, what is a magical girl? So there's a lot of debates. I actually talked about this with my bosses in the office. We were like, oh, what if we did a thing about like the best magical girls? So it's like, well, then we had to talk about like what actually that is, because by definition, it's just a girl that has magic.
Yeah.
Like, that's it. Like, it's not related to anime. It's just, so it's like Wonder Woman is kind of a magical girl in like some of the older shows, because she actually has like a transformation scene and everything.
Oh,
it's
interesting.
Like, yeah, like the older Wonder Woman stuff does. And so it's like, that's a good question to have.
I feel like it's broad, and in some ways that's good. I feel like, I don't know. I was thinking about it too, and it's like, oh, is it the squad thing? But there's also solo girls.
Yeah.
So like, it is pretty broad in the end, I think.
Yeah. So for the purposes of thinking of what we're doing, magical girls are, within our realm, mostly anime characters, and most likely have a transformation scene and something to transform with, or, you know,
Yeah. Some sort of gadget, wand, a thing. Weapon.
A pet.
No, I don't know.
You also have to have some sort of like familiar with them.
Yeah, familiar, yeah.
Almost always, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think that's where we kind of land on.
Cubey.
Cubey. That's kind of where we land on magical
cosmic power.
Yeah, there's a lot of like space.
Space is a really big part of being a magical girl.
Oh, it makes me so happy because I love space.
I love space.
Anyway, Sailor Moon's the best.
Oh, no. I think I freaked out on an episode once about how much I love space. Like weeks. Yeah. I was like, space.
Did anyone, when Pluto was downgraded from a planet, get offended for Sailor Pluto?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Offended for Sailor Pluto.
Like, do you know how much hard work she does?
Also, yeah. I was really offended that I remembered that mnemonic device and now it's useless.
Oh, yeah.
The My Very Eager Mother just served us nasty peas or something. Now I'm like, just served us nasty. Like, what? You know.
Man.
So I don't know a food that starts with N. I can't think of one. Non?
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
All right. But anyway. So space, I think, is a like cosmic power, not just like... You know, we talked a lot about the RPG-centric shows that are airing this season, like Grimgar, yeah. That's kind of RPG-esque. Like, having magic in that sense, like being a mage, is very different than being a magical girl.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Magical girls almost always have a theme. Like you said, we'll go with space, or it's like, we have a music theme, or a color theme,
or despair,
or element theme.
I was wondering if y'all consider Princess Tutu a magical girl anime. Have you seen that?
No.
Oh, okay. I wanted to ask. I was like, I think it is.
Does she transform into a ballerina?
Yeah, she does.
Does she really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And like, she doesn't have a familiar, but she does have this like little duckling form, so she's almost like her own familiar or something like that.
Okay, sold. That works.
Yeah.
She incredible. Doesn't change into a swan, like Swan Lake.
I forget exactly what happens. She might later in the show, but there is like a duckling element earlier in the show for sure. And she does have a transformation sequence, but I don't remember a specific wand, but she does transform into a ballerina and has these like, but she doesn't have like normal magical girl like fights. It's almost like more like dance offs, which I love.
That's a new take.
Yeah, that sounds like it fits the kind of trappings of the genre and does it differently.
Yeah, it's a little different. Yeah. So I think it's sort of on the edge, but probably still within it. Because she definitely does the whole transformation thing and has her, like, enemy that she's, like, you know, dancing with.
I think that she fits in the club.
Yeah, she's included.
It's also just beautiful and looks very much like a magical girl anime, which is why I saw it and I was like, I have to watch this. It's so pretty.
So I think we have a clear-ish definition. It's like, we know what we're talking about, at least.
Yeah.
So now I have to ask you guys, who are your favorite magical girls?
We all taking a breath.
I know mine. Well, so recently watched Revolutionary Girl Lieutena, and she's absolutely a magical girl. She has a transformation scene, and her magic is different because it comes from like a sword, and her transformation comes through more of a person who kind of like acts as her familiar in a way because like they're partners. And gosh, I just love it because I love shows that play with gender roles and saying like, hey, you can still be like have masculine traits and act in this way and like be feminine too. Like there's no problem with having both of that. And the big thing with Revolutionary Girl Lieutena is that she wants to be a prince. Like she's like, I'm a prince. That's my thing. And like other girls love her and then guys are like jealous of her and it's just the best how she controls that role and how also like a big part of it is society pushing back on her and saying like, hey, that's not what you're supposed to be doing. You should be a princess. You'd be better as a princess. And she's like, nah, man, I'll fight you. And it's so good. So she's definitely one of my favorites. And of course, the Sailor Moon. It's kind of like a given and an obvious. One of the things the most powerful with Sailor Moon is how she has like such an amazing transformation between her beginning and then the end. Like, if you've seen through all the Sailor Stars, like, this is not the same person.
Yeah.
But at the same time, she is. Like, she's still a crybaby sometimes, but she does grow out of it to an extent. And the way you see her mature is just so great. And I love all the themes and friendship and, yeah.
I love that it's also like totally okay that she's a crybaby. I feel like so often like a show would kind of make fun of the girl for being a crybaby, and they do kind of like tease her sometimes about it, but like ultimately everyone just accepts her for who she is, which I feel like is like a pretty powerful message to like show a girl who's like really vulnerable and young and growing and changing and is still a crybaby, and like that's totally okay. Like you can be that and still be like a strong person. And I always like, she reminds me of myself in that way. So I'm like, yeah, this anime accepts me for who I am.
Yeah. So it was weird because when I first watched it when I was a kid, like Sailor Mars was hands down my favorite, and she's still mostly my favorite, but going back and watching it as an adult, I was like, man, Sailor Moon is really good. Like, she's awesome.
Yeah.
Speaking of, like, gender, like, traditional gender roles and stuff, I really like Sailor Jupiter because she's, like, the tall, like, she has, like, masculine-ish traits, and so she goes hyper-feminine with it. She's like, I love baking, and I love homemaking, and I like her a lot because I really relate to that in the sense, like, you get pressured into being feminine sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so you get worried about being too masculine, so you overcompensate with the femininity. And so that, just her existence basically meant a lot to me. Like, just her being like that and seeing a reflection of that in a show was really important. I also really like Homura. Homura did nothing wrong. because I love her, and I love Kyoko. These are both from Puella Magia and Monica Magica. I like Kyoko a lot. I really like anime girls who care about their dads. I like Kyoko because, well, the whole thing about Monica is like the sacrificing something for someone else doesn't always work out.
Yeah.
And Kyoko's just so, oh, she's so good.
I just love Mommy. Oh, Mommy. Mommy's good. Anyway.
I feel like Mommy was my favorite in that show, too.
Yeah.
And it makes me sad because as much as I love Madoka.
No spoilers.
No spoilers. Okay, no. Just as much as I love Madoka, like, I never felt, I don't know, I always felt like I only had a very shallow understanding of her as a character for some reason.
I think there's a good reason for that, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fair. I think that made her not be my favorite, even though I'm like, I love her. She's so cute.
I don't think she's anybody's, like, true favorite.
I mean, it's, like, hard to have her that as that, though.
Yeah, because it is. Sayaka is, like,
no!
Sayaka is, like, basically Ariel from Little Mermaid. So I'm kind of like, okay. I think what I like about Homura is the way she puts walls up, and no spoilers, but like seeing where that comes from with her makes me relate to her a lot, and I feel like I have a very deep understanding of her character. And I, like I said, Homura did nothing wrong.
Does it count if I say, only half-jokingly, Umaru, who's the reverse magical girl who is perfect and pretty and helpful at school and then comes home and transforms into a total trash monster, and her magic power is to manipulate her brother into giving her whatever she wants.
I mean,
and eating junk food and not gaining any weight.
When you put it that way.
When you put it that way, Umaru is the anti-magical
she's
girl.
She's literally the antithesis of Sailor Moon. Like, everyone thinks she's perfect and pretty and she never cries, but when she gets home, as soon as that door shuts, she turns into a horrible human being. And I kind of like that. It's different. But if I were going to say magical girl, by our strict definition, it's a tie between Sailor Venus and Pluto. Mm-hmm. Sailor Venus is a really good leader. She can run up walls. She can chain whip people. But I think Pluto edges her out a little bit because of her stoicism and her maturity, and I relate more to that. She's sort of a lone wolf. There's unrequited love between her and King and Endymion. I cannot say his name all of a sudden. Tuxedo Mask.
Yeah.
But, I mean, her powers of time and space are pretty amazing, and they're the ones to beat. Like, at the end of the day, like, she and Sailor Saturn have some crazy powers that can basically destroy the universe. So... Mm-hmm. And she's just really pretty. She's my sailor queen. So props to Sailor Pluto. I still think of you as a planet.
I also think it's so interesting how, like, in the story, she is sort of separate. And so much of that show and manga is about like the ensemble cast, and it's interesting that they are like situated in all these different positions, sometimes in that group. Some of them are like sort of
like the outer senshi, but even the outer senshi kind of like there's this block. Like she's the outsider amongst all of them.
Yeah. And I think that's just that's really interesting. I like I like her arc.
Do you think that's why they declassified Pluto as a planet?
She's alone anyway.
She's alone anyway. So
Yeah.
Also shout out to Neptune and Uranus.
Yeah.
Just because.
They will make all of our
OTP.
Make all of our love lists forever.
Yeah. They're like the original OTP.
Yeah. You know, what about you?
I think my favorite, well, I mean, Sailor Moon, yes. Yeah. But other than Sailor Moon, I think my favorite might be Sakura from Cardcaptor Sakura.
Hey. Oh.
Yeah. I feel like Clamp has done, I mean, some of my favorite manga and anime of all time, but also some of like the best magical girl stuff between Cardcaptor Sakura and Magic Knight Rare, which I definitely consider a magical girl anime, even though it is like it is one of those other ones that's like super different from what you normally expect out of a magical girl anime. But I think that's cool because in Magic Knight Rare, like they have really cool like mechs and like they fight like in cool with cool swords and like they're more they have less of like the sparkly magical girl stuff that you'd see in like a Cardcaptor Sakura or a Sailor Moon. And it's more like kind of grungy almost. And I really like that different kind of tone. It kind of has the appeal of like a Madoka almost. That's like sort of a darker take on magical girl stuff. Yeah, Magic Knight Rae is great, but Cardcaptor Sakura has been one of my favorite shows since I was a child.
Yes.
And I just think like it's just one of those anime that, like, it still makes me laugh today, even though it's, like, totally, I'm like, oh, it's, like, about this little girl, but I relate to this, like, small child so much because she, you know, she, kind of like Sailor Moon, is really vulnerable, but she has, like, such beautiful friendships, and her and Tamayo also kind of, like, one of my original OTPs.
Oh, yeah. As everybody's, though.
Yeah, and, like, Tamayo with her camera. I don't know. I love them as a pair, and I love that Tamayo always made the costumes for Sakura.
Yeah.
And how in Cardcaptor Sakura, like, she has the transformation, but her costume is always made by her friend, and it's, like, so much about those relationships, and I always thought that that was so nice. And obviously, like, collecting all the cards, like, that's a really interesting idea for a magical girl anime, I think. So Sakura is probably one of my favorites.
Nice. Good choice. Thanks. We were just talking about that, actually, too.
Yeah.
Magical girl. Card captors.
Yeah. I used to have the Clow when I was a kid. And I'd run around with it at recess. I was really proud of my book.
That's adorable.
I've got it.
Yeah, Mike, what about you?
Well, Sakura, I agree with Nina. But in terms of Sailor Moon, I always gravitated towards Sailor Mars.
She's got the
fire. I just remember, yeah, exactly.
She's
I'm like,
so
this
good.
Girl's a badass.
Yeah, she is.
Oh, can we say that? Yeah.
For Sailor Mars. She's the exception.
Oh, yeah.
Accurate description.
I haven't seen the newest Sailor Moon, but she was always like the strongest character in my opinion in the team. And she's always kicks ass.
Yeah.
I like her and Sailor Moon, like, always fighting, too.
That's,
I think they're, like, really
cute. I love
their
sisterly relationship. Yeah. Like, I used to have Sailor Moon cards, and one of my favorite was a still shot of Sailor Mars and Sailor Moon pulling on each other's hair and mouths, so they're all skewed and weird-looking, and I was like, I wanted to frame that. I was like, I love this show so much. Because they were always fighting.
Yeah.
So it was great.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Totally. So to get on our next topic, it's kind of important. Like, why are magical girls so important? Like, why is that genre, like, such a big thing? And, I mean, obviously, it's a big entryway for a lot of younger women back in the day to anime. It's not the only one, but it spoke to us, like, in a different way. But what do you think it's, like, such a good genre to have? And, feels.
For me, I always think of it because, like, you know, it's one of the first anime I ever came across as a kid, and I feel like myself and probably a lot of other people always remember Sailor Moon and Dragon Ball Z as, like, the two, like, first anime that they ran into, at least in the States. And I just really liked that there was, like, the super hyper-masculine Dragon Ball Z and then a very feminine Sailor Moon, and you had both, and you could kind of watch either and just feel like, okay, I can go between these two shows and sort of get what I want at any given moment. And I always liked that there was, like, an alternative. I always felt like there was so much. I would go online and just always find super, like a One Piece or a Bleach or something that I was like, I don't really see any girl characters in this that I really relate to. As a kid, at least. Like, as an adult, it's a little different. So it was nice to feel like there was something out there that I felt like was being made for me as a kid. That's like a really powerful thing that Sailor Moon did, and a lot of like also Cardcaptors I remember watching when I was a kid too. A lot of the Magical Girl stuff, I'm just like, as a kid, that stuff meant so much to me, and I think that that's like a really important
thing. It's empowering. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like the fact that Sailor Moon is always saving Tuxedo Mask. Like, mm-hmm. I've never seen that in an anime, and that she relied on her friends, and that magical girls have some sort of power within themselves. Mm-hmm. I found it very empowering.
Yeah, I relate to that a lot, because a lot of Western stuff falls into this habit of having the one female character. Like, if you look at ensemble casts, the most recent examples I can think of are Avengers and Guardians of the Galaxy. You have the one female character in the ensemble, and it's really tough when you watch a bunch of movies and everybody's super into these movies as a kid. I mean, I wasn't a kid when they came out, obviously, but you know, the boys always had multiple people to look up to. Not that girls can't look up to boys and vice versa, but I liked anime because, especially magical girl anime, because there were so many female characters that I could pick parts of them I saw that reminded me of myself, and I didn't feel trapped into being like the one girl. Mm-hmm. And it was really important because it felt like, you know, this is what my life is like. I have women around me all the time, and I never felt like I could relate to other women because we were all trying to be the same one girl. And with magical girl anime, it was much more like, well, I like this Sailor Scout and you like this one, and there's room for both of us to be ourselves. Yeah. And that's why it's so important to me, is knowing that you don't have to be like every other person you see. You can pick out parts and make it your own and be yourself.
Yeah, I think also a big thing, we saw like the coming of superheroes, and like that's such a big deal in society and stuff and just culture. And you notice most of them are men, mm-hmm. and that's a thing. And like, cool, I love Batman and all these things. But then if you look at magical girl stuff, like that's like where all the lady superheroes are hiding, mm-hmm. almost in a weird way.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, Sailor Moon was so like important to me growing up too, and now. Because like it teaches a lot about like friendship too. It's just like, hey, mm-hmm. you guys can be strong together, mm-hmm. and like that's really important, because you know, kind of like in the geek culture, it's easy to kind of feel left out, especially if in your place where there's not a lot of women who are into the same things as you.
Yeah, and you feel like you're competing for the one spot of woman all
right.
the time.
Like, mm-hmm. that's how I felt in my groups all the time. I was like, oh, there's another girl coming, but do I know more than her? You know, yeah, like, am I better?
You feel the competition.
Which is awful.
It's a horrible feeling to, like, Miranda and I talked about this, like, when I first started working here, we were like, both sort of like, that's a lot of plushies on her desk.
Is it, do I have more cute things on my desk than her?
I was like, what if I got more plushies, though? And we, you know, because we're adults, we had a conversation about it. But when I was younger, it was very much like, I had my sort of reverse harem of boys, and right. I was sort of protective over that. I was like, you don't talk to my boys. Like,
yeah, me too. Like, you had to outshine every other girl there because, yeah. like, we had this notion that like there's only room for one.
You're competing for the spot of like the girl, like she's the cool girl who plays the cool games and likes cool stuff. And so I would pretend I didn't like certain types of games. I wouldn't tell anybody I liked Animal Crossing. I was just like, yeah, I'm gonna go home and play Halo. Let's go play. I mean, I like Halo. That's not to put down Halo. I just like would very much push down everything else and just be like, yeah, let's play online because I'm the cool girl. And then I grew out of that real fast, but and I'm glad I did. But I think that sort of the culture that we're in creates that and perpetuates that. And so coming here, actually, and like talking to other women about anime and about all our favorite female characters and realizing if there's room for all the senshi, yeah. there's room for all of us. Yeah.
Yes. I think it's so good also that they just show friendship between women alongside romance.
Yeah.
And I feel like when I was a kid, like I probably wasn't even aware of this at the time, but like I could see not only myself but like my actual friendships, I could kind of like see them in these anime, because I was mm-hmm. like, yeah, like my two best friends are these girls, and mm-hmm. like then I can go watch Cardcaptor Sakura and see Sakura and Tamayo like going out and having fun together and being amazing and just being friends, and have like sort of a romance story happening alongside that, but have those like exist in harmony rather than having one show just be entirely about the like boy and the girl romance. Like mm-hmm. there's so much more to like human relationships than like just love, and there's different kinds of love. There's love between friends.
Totally. And that's, like, that's one big thing about Sailor Moon, too, is, like, mm-hmm. we always go back to Sailor Moon because it's such a big, like, monument within the magical girl franchise. Like, it's a genre, and it's so important because it did set up a lot of these foundations for so many people, too. It's just so good. Everything is so good.
They pass the Bechdel test often, which is also good.
So let us know what you guys think about magical girls. Like, do you guys kind of pick up on the same things as us? What are your favorite series? We want to know. And you can also talk with us about Magical Girls in our Facebook group, which you can find at facebook.com/group/IGN Anime Club. It's called the IGN Anime Club official group, and we love to have you there, and we can have great conversations.
And it's the best.
It is.
It really is,
and talk about fan art and...
lots of fan art.
Great things.
Some cosplay.
Memes. It's a good time.
Some memes.
It is known to be the most welcoming and nicest anime group online. Yeah. Basically, by word of mouth, people are joining. Because they're like, oh, a place where I can talk about anime without fear and without being reprimanded by other people. That's what we're about. It's like, whether you've seen one anime or a million anime, you are welcome either way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, before Megan has to leave.
I do have to leave.
So this is UDC week, which is while we get Nina.
Yeah.
So, yay!
So, yay, Nina. Also, yay. We have stuff we really have to go to.
I wanted to have a super quick debate about Sailor Moon Crystal. So this got some problems.
And Megan reviewed Sailor Moon Crystal for a very long time for IGN.
Literally for a year.
Yeah.
So,
wow.
Yeah, 26 episodes. It's still going. Like, the third, what we now know as Sailor Moon S with the Outer Senshi coming out is now... out.
Yeah, they finally just started the promotional stuff for it. I think it comes out next season.
Yeah, I think it starts in spring. So April.
Yeah, so
I was so turned off by the animation. Rapid fire. No.
No.
Okay, go on.
Yeah, I think, so Sailor Moon Crystal got delayed for a long time. I think it was delayed by a year. And so it was kind of concerning. It was like, well, hopefully it's okay. Maybe the more time will make it a better show. Nope.
So my main thought about Sailor Moon Crystal that kind of disappointed me quite a bit was that it doesn't have any of that humor that the original anime had that the manga actually didn't really ever have.
Yeah.
And I felt like the anime did so well with that kind of like slapstick joke stuff that they did. And I was always like, that's what I like. I like the filler episodes in Sailor Moon.
They
like,
were
that was my favorite part of the show.
Yeah.
Except for like later on, it kind of gets a little monotonous with the Monster of the Week type of thing.
Yeah, that's
fair. Don't really build on it. Yeah. Like it doesn't happen until like way later though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think Sailor Moon Crystal, not having that, it made it just appeal to me a lot less.
Yeah.
It also, from my take, it takes too literal from the manga.
Mm-hmm.
Like, here's this frame, now here's this frame. Mm. And it kind of just moves too quickly through that to the point where you never really get character development aside from like Serena or Usagi, whoever you want to call her, Sailor Moon.
Yeah.
And so I think that's a big problem because like everyone else just feels like background noise. Yep.
Cool. So I watched 26 episodes of the show.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to defend, like, the animation was definitely inconsistent. It's something that I mentioned. But I have to say that the art direction was actually pretty good. It had some really cool shots. And I actually liked that it followed the manga better because all throughout the original Sailor Moon, I couldn't figure out what the bleep was going on half the time. Because of those Monsters of the Week, it would get skewed. So even though Tuxedo Melvin is still my favorite episode of all time, fight me. I actually did like that it followed the manga better because I could actually follow the story. Some of the characters in the original show were dumbed down, like Sailor Venus is regulated way to the background. She comes much more forward in the manga, so she became one of my favorite sailors. Freudian slip or slip of the tongue? You decide. But I just thought it was really cool. Mars is a lot more tolerable in this one because I had a love-hate relationship with her in the 90s where I was like, I loved her, but at the same time, I hated her. I hated her snottiness and her entitlement and was like, light yourself on fire,
girl. That was me as a child, so I related.
But I just felt like there were a lot of benefits to following the manga more literally. One being, now I know what is going on. Mm-hmm. And if there's a problem with this story, it's because the original source, let's be honest, like the art is beautiful and I had all the art books, but the source was never good to begin with. So whether it's Monster of the Week or the manga, the series makes no sense anyway, but at least it makes more sense with the manga. Although I do miss the original music because the original music was awesome.
I think the manga does a decent job of following Sailor Moon, but the problem with the anime is because we were familiar with having this development with everybody else and having them feel left out feels wrong.
Well, I don't know. I mean, the truth is, I'm just going to use their American names. So, like,
I know,
it's Molly and Melvin and all those people. You know, it's they weren't.
Molly's side stuff was amazing. Sad.
Oh no!
I cried.
No. Oh, we all cried. We all cried when Neflite. Nope. But I just think that it was a big distraction. I mean, if we're perfectly honest, we were entertained by it, but it was really stretching things out a bit to the point where it was like, what is going on here? Now I don't even know. And things were cut out and put out of order. Of course, that could also be Deke's terrible translation, kissing cousins and all that.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's kind of like, I think for all the amazing thing the 90s cartoon does, it just didn't make sense and it kept wandering off into kind of weird territory.
I think a problematic thing though with the new anime is how they pair up all of the Sailor Senshi with their matching guardian, where like Mamoru's people, like the
but that was in the manga.
Yeah, but they do it in like a real awkward way.
Well,
it's a very bad way.
Well, I mean, the 90s cartoon took liberties, whereas like Malachite and Zoisite were never a couple in the manga, and they threw them together, and I liked them as a couple, but that was like a weird thing that they like. They took things and they were very liberal with it. And it was like,
that's one of the things I liked about it, that it was liberal and that it made it its own. It made like this other great universe for Sailor Moon, like another retelling of the story that felt more personal and better for
it. But it didn't make sense. It's like, what? why is Jedi and Malachite? I keep saying Malachite. I forget what his actual name is, but it was Malachite when I was growing up. But like their importance was weird, like all over the place. And then in the manga, it's like, oh, that's what they're supposed to be. They're supposed to be, because didn't you ever feel sorry for these girls? Like Sailor Moon gets her dream prince. These girls get, you know, nothing. So I don't know. I just thought it made more sense. Now there's a reason where it's like, oh, that's why these people are in there. That's their tie to Mamoru and all that stuff. So
yeah. And also to be fair, Mamoru also gets powers. Like he's more empowered, I think, in the newer stuff and in the manga.
Yeah.
Whereas in the 90s he was just like, ooh,
he's a professional. That was cool. He was like, oh, you're the prince of the earth. You actually have powers. That's cool, as opposed to being the very fancily dressed you know, Dallas cheerleader.
It's like, why doesn't he do anything?
But I do like that he emotionally supported her.
Yeah.
That was really
I do
nice
like
role reversal.
His role, but I think it was really surprising when I did eventually read the manga that's like, oh, he had powers too.
Yeah, he was actually useful in some regard.
Yeah.
He didn't just throw a rose and give a lecture. All right. On that note,
So anyway, we hope the next one is better. Let us know what you think about Sailor Moon Crystal. We hope you enjoy it. Yeah, debates.
Yeah.
That was the most rapid fire. That was
I know.
So
that was
cool.
Good.
Let's hurry up.
That was really impressive.
Forever,
very concise. Okay, I will see you guys next week. Joy GDC. Awesome.
Bye, Megan.
Bye.
Okay.
I'm
going
to get my stuff out of the way. I'm going to take my magical trash monster with me, by the way.
Okay, so for like our last magical girl topic thing, I just want to talk about sidekicks.
Yes.
I think that's a good one to like end on.
Yeah.
Like we were talking about before, like they all have these like great familiars.
Familiars, yeah.
And also trash ones.
Can I talk about Cube?
Can
I just talk about
Cube?
You kind of have to. He's such a key familiar.
One of the reasons I love Homura so much is when she just like shoots Cube, just like destroys him, knowing like it's not gonna do anything because he's like this much more powerful being than he appears, but just the satisfaction of just continually trashing him feels good. I hate him so much. He's a manipulative, like the thing about Cube that I think causes me to hate him so much is he's manipulative the way people are manipulative. You know, you want this, don't you? Like, if you really want this, you need to do this for me. And I feel like a lot of people have had people talk to them to like that before in relationships or outside of relationships. And so he's very a fantastical character. Like, it's clearly not real, but it feels sort of real to me. The manipulation is very, I don't know, it creeps me out. It's too close to home. So
I feel like what's interesting about Cube is that he is like so different from other magical girl anime familiars in that, like, you know, he's not like a Luna who's like always there for Sailor Moon. Like, mostly you see the, magical girl sidekicks are like just very supportive, not usually super well-developed characters that are kind of just there. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty, it's a pretty interesting take on that. Yeah. I think what they did with Kyubey, which I won't get too into that because of spoilers.
Yeah,
but,
too much.
But I think that taking sort of a trope like that and totally like twisting it and like turning it inside out, I always get excited about that, even though I also terribly hate the character. But I appreciate what they did in writing that.
Yes.
Yeah. It was really smart.
Yeah.
Mike, I actually think you added one on here.
You know what? Yeah, I'm not sure who added Happy. That was not me.
Who added Happy?
But I love Happy. Okay, so Happy.
Megan.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, well, I mean, I have tons to say about Happy, actually. yeah, Happy is Natsu's sidekick in Fairy Tale.
Is Natsu actually a magical girl?
I'm not sure why he's on here. But, I mean, as a sidekick for... I'm just going to say Natsu's a magical girl for now. He's kind of like the most useless one, but you know, he assists Natsu because, you know, he's more of a, he's just there for him, like emotionally, like he's their friends, and he says Aisa all the time. I mean, he's when you need him the most, he'll be there for you for sure. And then when he's there in a serious situation, he'll be there to just mess up. So he's, I don't want to say he's the best sidekick. He's definitely one of the worst. But but I love him to death. So, yeah.
I would love to shout out two of my favorite magical girl sidekicks, being both created by Clamp. I'm obsessed with Clamp, by the way. One, so Mokona. Mokona being the little rabbit that... I think Mokona is really interesting because Mokona is in so many different Clamp series and is almost like the just Clamp familiar. It's like they almost made a familiar from themselves because they're basically magical women and I love them. So I like to believe that Mokona really exists and is their little sidekick. So I love Mokona. And also Kiro from Cardcaptor Sakura is like one of the funniest characters in anime ever.
Yeah.
I can never get the image of him doing his little Kononachiwa bit where he like spins around really slowly at the end of every episode. I love Kiro.
That's one of the few things, like I watched Cardcaptor Sakura as a kid and I somehow don't really remember much of it. That's like one of the only things I remember. So it's just like stuck with me because it's so iconic and great.
It holds up as an adult. I rewatched it like a year ago. Still hilarious, amazing, beautiful. Highly recommend watching it again as an adult. Really good.
Yep. That's a goal. And we can't really talk about the familiars and Amoklass sidekicks without Luna and Artemis.
Yeah.
How many people have cats named Luna and Artemis now because of Sailor Moon?
That is very true. And their human forms. Amazing. So amazing. Yeah, so I love that.
Oh my gosh, whenever Luna transformed for the first time, I was astounded. I was like, what is happening? What?
Yeah.
And that movie, like, I think it was the second one they
Hearts
released.
And Ice?
Yeah. That is, like, actually probably my favorite Sailor Moon movie. And I just love that the focus is Luna in that movie. Mm-hmm. Like, she's basically the main character.
It's very rare when you have that. Like, because the familiars are just there to be, you know, helpful and a guide and also a guide for, you know, us to know what's going on. But Luna... it's just like, nah, man, I'm more important than that. And she is. And it's so great to see how she takes an active part in Sailor Moon, how she's written in
well. And the scene where she's crying makes me cry.
I just love magical girl stuff.
Magical girls.
Yeah, I think kind of having a familiar or animal sidekick is, now that I think about it, is pretty much a standard with most of them.
Yeah.
Because I'm only because I'm thinking about the... what's it called? The magical boy anime that recently happened. And that was kind of like how I almost defined things. It's like, okay, what are the things that they checked off to make sure this was a magical boy thing?
Yeah.
It was really weird.
Yeah.
I mean, they all had like animal sidekicks. They had their own, you know, theme. Like one was love, one was other things.
Yeah.
And man, anyway, that's a thing that exists. I just needed to shout that out because it's weird and they have... weird sidekicks.
Yeah.
Anyway, so is there anything else you guys want to talk about?
Oh, actually, one other sidekick that I just remembered, and I can't do this episode without mentioning this. It's so important. Tokyo Mew Mew.
Oh, yeah.
I always forget about Tokyo Mew Mew, but, like, totally one of the cutest magical girl anime ever. Mm-hmm. So they're all, like, if you haven't seen it, all the magical girls each, like, have an animal form. So, like, the main girl is a cat, so she has, like, cat ears when she transforms. Mm-hmm. She's super cute. She shares the same birthday with me, I believe. Which is today, and
yay!
I always
yay! Happy birthday!
Tokyo Mew. Also, happy birthday, Ichigo, in Tokyo Mew Mew, which I always got excited about as a kid. Her sidekick is like that little puffball. I totally can't remember what its name is, but it's basically like a little pink puffball that looks like a keychain, which I just think is like really hilarious. Like, her sidekick's basically like a little keychain that is alive. I want one of those.
Oh, again, no. almost happened. Sorry, I have a feeling coming. Such a good one. They're all so cute.
I love it. And the art in that one is just so adorable.
Cool. Well, thank you guys for joining us in talking about magical girls. They're all great. There's like, of course, a billion other shows that I wish we could talk about too.
We have Sailor Moon. So many shows.
But
to
what
talk
about Sailor Moon?
Not enough time.
I'm just thinking about Mermaid Melody, Peachy Peachy Peach now. I'm like, all these magical girl animes are running through my head.
I had a list and then I forgot to bring it as like the ones I need to talk about. I'm like, never mind.
There's just too many. There's too much good anime.
That's the hard part. And a lot of them are older too. Like, it's good to remember that there's those kind of things too. Anyway, so we need to move on to our watch party winner. So we just concluded Gurren Lagann. If you guys haven't joined us for a watch party before, what we do is we watch two episodes of a show chosen by you guys every week. And we talk about them and break them down, find the cool Easter eggs, or freak out, cry, you know, whatever. Whatever we have to do.
Your husbando dies.
Yeah.
You know.
It's
still sad.
So, starting next week, I'm super, super happy to announce we're watching Shirobako! I saw it on my phone because the poll ended and I was like, what?
Yeah, that poll was intense.
It was like 11 p.m. or something. I was still here and Miranda was texting me like, oh my god! Because if you're a long-time listener, watcher, you'll know I have Shirobako pen from Japan that I use every week, and I'm really excited to finally do Shirobako.
So if you don't know what Shirobako is about, it's about some girls who decide they want to work in the anime industry, and like, this is their dream, this is their goal. And it's about them doing it. Like, all these different positions, too. Like, one's a producer, like, one's a voice actress, and one, or tries to be, and, like, all these things that they're attempting to do. And
yeah, they all have their own, like, specialty within the industry, and they want to work together. Their goal is to make an anime together.
Yeah.
So I think this one's going to be an interesting watch party, because Miranda and I have already seen it.
Yes. I've actually already seen all the shows we've watched, so.
Right, yeah. So, right, like, yeah.
Yeah.
But I think it's easier to talk about because we've already seen it.
So we can bring more to the table.
We can bring, not that we didn't before, in a different way. But because this has to do with the anime industry, because we do anime stuff at work, hopefully you try out the show, you know, hopefully.
Yeah, I hope you guys like it.
I'm super excited because we would have had four sci-fi shows in a row, which nothing wrong with sci-fi. I love sci-fi, but I'm excited for maybe a change of pace and hopefully people
Honestly,
who...
I voted for Shirobako. Sorry, Psycho Pass guys. I mean, I just finished Psycho Pass, so I was like,
watch it all over again.
And then it went up like 200, like, But yeah, it's I'm excited. I haven't seen this, so I can't wait to check it out.
Yeah,
it was. Have you seen it?
I haven't seen it. I might have to watch along with this. It's been recommended to me like quite a bit. So. Yeah,
it's one of the few that I'm like, you have to watch this one if you love anime. Mm-hmm. Also, if you don't, just watch it anyway because it's great.
It's so good.
It sounds really interesting to me personally because I've been really obsessed with finding interesting interviews with women manga artists, and I've been reading a ton of Naoko Takeuchi and Clamp interviews. And I think it would be cool to kind of like contextualize that in like a show form and just like see the connections if there are any, which I'm sure there are.
Yeah.
And the cool thing is that it does have influence from like real creator stories. And like there's cameos and here, and a lot of good references, like, oh, I know what they're talking about here because it's, you know, something prolific in anime. And it kind of just gives us a better understanding of like what goes into making anime. Of course, it's not a one-to-one real life workplace situation,
right?
But you know, it gives you perspective, and that's important too. So we'll be starting that next week, the first two episodes. It's available on Blu-ray. Crunchyroll. And if you want a Crunchyroll 30-day trial, you can go to crunchyroll.com/IGN. So I think usually they only have like a 15-day trial, but that one will get you 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
And Hulu.
Yeah.
So it's available in many places. Also, shout out to everybody in the group who campaigned for their favorites. So this time we only had Psycho Pass, FLCL, and Shirobako. And you guys are awesome. So, and that was
it was in the Facebook super cool group. To watch. Even though it was well known that Miranda and I were campaigning for Shirobako,
I didn't even get to give my like big speech. I was ready to do it, and then I missed the past two episodes.
I mean, I would have been happy with whatever happened, but it was really cool to see people, you know, really going for their favorite show and supporting their favorite show. So
There was artwork and everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. Chris George was super intense on campaigning for Psycho Pass and made Psycho Pass themed promotions.
Wow.
Yeah,
and that's
was
cool.
That's awesome. Yeah, it was
next
awesome.
Time,
and
Chris
then,
George, we'll get them next time.
Yeah. thank you for that. It was part of my favorite thing these past week or so. He also made this really long message as if it were from the show. Like you're saying, we'll get it next time, guys, essentially. Yeah.
It was
really good.
So cool.
So thanks for that.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for everybody for participating, and I hope you guys enjoy this next watch party.
Oh, yeah. Can't wait.
So we will get to that soon. Nina,
Hi.
Where can people find you on the internet?
Oh, yes. So you can find me on Twitter. I'm at HentaiPhD.
I'm pretty sure, are going to be sad we don't talk about that.
I know. I don't really have a PhD in hentai. It's a joke because I think it's interesting and funny. I have a master's, though, so I at least have something. HentaiPhD on Twitter. My website is ninasays.so. NINASAYS.SO. I love my URL. And I have a lot of free games on my site, free flash games and stuff if you want to check out my stuff. Also, Cybele is out, and there's a link to that on my site. You can also go to CybeleGame.com, CibeleGame.com. And that's out. It has actually a lot of like anime references in it.
Yes.
So if you're interested in some anime nostalgia, you might want to check out the game. It also has a magical girl inspired wallpaper in it.
It
you can
does.
Get that wallpaper on our site. We have it up, so if you like it, you can use it. That's all my stuff. And thank you so much for having me as a guest on the show.
Yay,
I've been watching
you.
Since like episode one, so
I'm
a huge fan. And I was telling them earlier, I have the Anime Club shirt, and I totally forgot to bring it. I'm so sad because I wanted to wear it. I love it.
If you want to get yourself a shirt, you can go to go.ign.com/store.
It's super cute.
Also, play How Do You Do It.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Oh my gosh, it is so good.
How Do You Do It is so good.
Thank
also
you.
Freshman year.
Those are also both
like
free on my site.
Big fangirls of each other. How do you do it?
It's
so good.
How Do You Do It is a game where you mash dolls together in a way, and it's a cute little game about childhood sexuality based on my own life. And it's free on Steam, also on my site, so you might like it. I think a lot of people were excited about it last year when I brought it to GDC, so it's excited that people are still playing it.
We were playing in the office not too long ago, too.
Yeah,
oh my gosh.
We sat around and we're like, because it doesn't take that long to play. You mm-hmm. kind of go through and see what options and mm-hmm. but it's like what options are available and how it ends and stuff. But we like sat around and we're like giggling, like,
oh my god. I was like, hey, remember when you did this as a kid?
This is like Quap, but with dolls.
Yeah.
And like,
definitely inspired by Quap in a sense. It takes a couple minutes to play. It's very, very tiny. It's a little vignette.
I would recommend.
Cool. Callie, where can they find you?
I'm at Inkidojiko, INKYDOJIKKO. I posted a nice collage of angry anime girls to reflect how I feel. So if you like that sort of thing and more, you should follow me there. Also, Jigglypuff was angry in the collage.
Oh, so. That happened. It was really good.
Yeah.
You can find me on Twitter at HavocGross. I'm there. That's about it.
And you can follow me at XPEminem is on Twitter as well.
Okay. And you guys have anything else to plug? Anything we're working on?
We got GDC South by Southwest is happening this week, so please check out our content there. Then Super Torment.
Super Team 64.
Blah, blah, blah. Yeah.
Which we already talked
Check
about.
Check that out, too.
Go
yes, again.
For Sailor Moon.
There you go. But yes.
Yeah, if you want to see all our GDC content, it's at IGN.com/events/GDC. Mm-hmm. We have a hub, so you can catch up on everything. Unfortunately, the Pokemon Go event was canceled.
Ugh. Yeah.
It's going to go. I was really upset, but there's a lot of cool stuff there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A lot of cool previews, because we had the Indie Mixer here at IGN. Mm-hmm. It was the 5th anniversary of the Indie Mix, which was really cool, and yeah, there were some interesting
cake.
Things. There was a Hello Kitty cake.
I did not eat that cake.
There was a Hello Kitty ice cream cake, and it was like all I ate that whole day, but it was worth it. So, yeah, just go to that if you're interested. There's some cool sort of like, because we've had people, you know, in the comments on the Facebook group kind of saying, you know, oh, I'm not super interested in games, but I've learned a little bit about games from you guys.
Nice.
These are the kinds of games, if you're not interested in like AAA games, GDC is the indie stuff, and a lot of the cool GDC games we see are more experimental, maybe story driven. Mm-hmm. So if you're not super into an Uncharted or I don't know if that's the first one I thought of. I've never played Uncharted. I don't know why I thought of Uncharted. If you're not into like a Call of Duty or anything like that, this is the time to really check out maybe some games that you'd be into.
Actually, just shout out to the game I'm working on with Fulbright right now. Yeah. Tacoma. If you like story-driven games, we're working on it right now. There's a cool trailer at tacoma-game.com. I hope everyone will get excited about it. I think it's going to be really cool. It's like also has sci-fi elements. And I know you guys watched a lot of like sci-fi anime.
Our group likes sci-fi.
It's like definitely like a human-oriented sci-fi kind of game.
Yeah.
And it's not out yet, but please look out for it. I think people might be really into it.
Yeah, we saw that at E3, I think. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Oh, yeah.
Cool. Please go read my anime reviews. I reviewed Psycho Pass, the movie, and The Boy and the Beast. Please,
she worked
you.
So hard, and she was like, I have to work over the weekend.
Yeah. There's been a lot going on.
Yeah.
So,
please support those.
Yeah, support our stuff. We really appreciate it. And thank you for supporting us. Thank you for listening to the show. Nina, thank you so much for coming on.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Thank you so much.
I already can't wait till next year. We can have you on again.
Yes.
So.
Yes, please. I love Anime Club. Yay, anime.
Yay. Yay. All right. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Don't forget to watch Shirobako. We love you all. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next week. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.